As part of day one agenda, we're going to discuss about today the Java introduction, Java execution flow, the variables, how are we going to create variables in Java, data types in Java, the conditional statements. So let's get into the first topic, Java introduction. So before we get into writing any programs in Java, it is important that we should be having these prerequisites in our laptop. The first thing is we should be having JDK, which we can install. The clear instructions are given in this video. Please go to this video to install JDK in your laptop. And also for downloading Eclipse, the instructions are provided in this video. Now, let's look into the introduction part. So Java was originally developed by James Gosling at Sun Microsystems, which has been acquired by Oracle and released in 1995. As a core component of Sun Microsystems Java platform. So it is almost, if you look into this from 1995 to till now, it's almost more than 25 years the Java has been developed. 25 years back, the Java has been developed, and it is mainly developed by James Gosling. He is working in a project, mainly in Sun Microsystems. The project name is called as Oak. Okay, and recently, I think in 2010, Oracle has been acquiring Sun Microsystems. Now currently Oracle is owning the Java right now. And one more important point about Java, Java is open source. Java supports object-oriented programming concepts. When I say object, object is a real-world entity. For example, car, bike, animal, pen, pencil, all are objects. And also very important feature of Java is platform independent. So what is platform independent? We'll see an example. But before getting into that, let's try to understand the Java execution flow. So, and also let's get into the topic like Java is case sensitive. What is case sensitive means here, the uppercase and lowercase both are different. It means when I declare I equal to 5, when I declare I equal to 5, if you look into these two statements, the difference is the I here is uppercase, the I here is lowercase, both are different. It is case sensitive. Suppose you declare a variable with lowercase, you cannot refer the variable with the uppercase in the program. Make sure we try to provide the same variable name and same case so that it will be referring to the same variable name. So let's look into the topic of Java execution flow. So whenever you write a program, let me write a program in Java. But before getting into writing the program, this is our first program we are going to write now. Let me write it in a notepad. I'll open notepad. I write on the same thing. Just copy the same information. The first program, I'll copy this, put it in a notepad. Now, when you look into this program, it has so many special characters, right? The curly braces. This is the curly brace. This is start of the class block. This is the end of the class block. The class block is mainly start with the curly braces and end with the curly braces. Okay. This is a method block where it starts with curly braces, ends with the curly braces. And also you can see there are square brackets. This is mainly to represent an array. Okay, square brackets. And this is parenthesis, right? For a method, we've just put parenthesis. And every statement in a Java program within the block ends with a semicolon. Then you have a double quotes to represent the string here. And you have a comment section where you can mention about the short description about this line of statement. So all these special characters, we should be aware of it in the program. Now we have copy pasted this 4 lines or 5 lines here into a notepad. Then how do we save this file? It's always important that we can save the file with a name same as the class name, and we have to give the extension as .java. Means I will save this file with the name as helloworld.java. Okay, so let me try to save it. Let me take the path here. Just take the path of the Java classes day one. Day one will save this file. Okay, let me save this. Save as, just put the path here. Okay, I just put the path here as say hello world. Java. I can just select the type as all files. It is important we have to select the type as all files and click on save. So it will be saving into the location. You can see the file is getting saved. Then after that, let's try to compile the Java program. It is important that when I just give dir, I know that this file, the hello world.java, you can identify here. I'll just mark it for your information. This is the file name which is available in this location. The directory is this location. In this location, this file is available, which is a Java file. So what we have to do as part of Java execution flow, the first step is we have to compile. How do we compile the program? If you wanted to compile the Java program, particularly Java C, and the program name dot Java. Then click on enter. Once we enter Java C hello world.java, once we enter this, we didn't get any output. What happened? Just give dir again. You see the difference here? The difference is, let me try to highlight the difference now. So see the difference here. This has only the hello world.java which is available. But what is happening when you try to compile the program? Suppose I compile this program like this, Java C, the program name.java. What happened is it generated a class file. So when you compile the program, what happens? We get a class file. It is very important. So what is the content of the class file? The content of the class file is bytecode. The content of the class file is bytecode. This is a step one. What is the step one? The step one is Java C hello world.java as part of execution flow. This is a step one, right? This is our step one. Then what we do after that is, what is step two here? The step two here is, let me just give CLS to clear the screen. The step two is Java, just mention program name. That's it. You get the output. So how many steps we have completed right now? Totally two steps, one for compilation, one for, this step is called as for execution. We executed the program to get the output. So these two steps we should execute in sequence. Java C, the program name.java, Java, the program name to get the output in the console. So what happened here? Let's try to understand in a flow chart now. So if you look into the execution flow, what happened right now? Let me highlight it. Suppose here you write a program. You write a Java program. What happened after that? Then when you compile the program, you compile the program, right? So what happened when you compile the program? Then you get a bytecode. When you compile the program, what happened? You get a bytecode. Then this bytecode is nothing but the class file, which we got as hello world.class. The JRE, which is mainly responsible for the execution of the program, the JRE contains JVM, which is responsible for execution of the program, and we get the output in the console that is showing the CPU, that sends the instructions to the CPU and displays the output in the console. So this is the execution flow. There are steps one, two steps. If you complete, you get the outcome. So let me try to highlight. This is the first step, this is the second step, and we get the output. And this entire section, if you look into this entire section, suppose for example, this entire section, I can find out, I can highlight this entire section. This entire section we call as JDK. What is JDK? Java Development Kit. So the Java compiler and the JRE together we call as JDK. The Java compiler plus JRE. What is JRE? Java Runtime Environment, which contains JVM responsible for execution of the program. And also we call JVM as an interpreter. What does it mean by interpreter? Interpreter means it will try to execute line by line. It doesn't execute the whole program, it executes line by line. That's the reason we call JVM as an interpreter. So when I say JDK, it's a combination of compiler plus JRE. In JRE, the JVM is responsible for execution of the program. So in these two steps of the execution flow, first step is compilation, second step is execution to get the output. Okay, so now let's move on. We write the program, we execute the program, we got the output, right? Let's move on now. So we're able to understand, and also we have written some points here. Class contains only one main method. Yes, that's what we have done. Hello world is different from hello world. Why? Because Java is case sensitive. It is important that we have to give the same name as a class name for saving the program name. So I have given some points to make sure we follow them. The program name should be given as the same name as a class name. That's right. We have followed the same thing. The Java program is saved with the extension .java. Yes, this is also followed. Java execution flow contains two steps. First step is compilation. Yes. Then second step is execution. So these two steps are clearly mentioned in the document for reference. Now, the fourth point is Java is platform independent. What does it mean? Because we have seen the Java execution flow of two steps. But why Java is platform independent? The reason being Java is platform independent is here. Look into the entire execution flow again. Click into the entire execution flow again. What happened here is, let me highlight that as well. So whenever we get a class file, suppose I get a class file. This class file is same for all the operating systems. Let's take suppose Linux or Mac or Windows. We have considered totally three operating systems right now. Suppose if I wanted to compile on Windows and try to execute on Linux, yes, that is possible. The class file which is generated in the Windows operating system can be used on Linux operating system. But what is important, we need a Linux JVM to execute the program. Okay, that's the reason the class file which is generated in the case of Java makes Java platform independent. What is platform independent? The class file generated when you compile the program, it is same for all the operating systems. We don't need to compile again. Suppose I have a Windows operating system, I compile the program, I will share the class file to someone who is having Linux operating system. What they should do, they just make sure they should be having Linux JVM, which is responsible for execution of the program. That's it. That is the main objective of platform independent. So Java we call as platform independent, the reason being the class file is same across all the operating systems. Now let's move on. Okay, now this is what we mentioned, and also for reference I had given you what is JDK, what is JRE, what is JVM. So compile once and execute on any platform. When I say platform, it's an operating system. Compile once and execute on any platform with specific JVM. As I mentioned, Linux JVM you need, Mac JVM you need, Windows JVM you need for the operating system. So this entire topic is about Java introduction and Java execution flow, and also why Java is platform independent. So all these three points are covered in this introduction part. Now, next point. Let's move on. What is agenda? As per our agenda, the next point is variables. Okay. So let's create some variables now. Let me open the program again. Let's create some variables. So mainly, how do we create variables? We always create variables using a data type, variable name. Okay, this we call as declaration. Then we have to initialize the variable also. Suppose, for example, if you are initializing the variable, say, suppose you have a method, one more method, public void display. There's one more method you are creating. And in this method, you are trying to put I is equal to, say, 10. This is called initialization. So you declare it, and you initialize it. What is initialization? You are assigning a value to a variable. So in order to describe this data type is mandatory and we can give any variable name to store the value. But what are the different data types are available in Java, right? Because without data types, we cannot create a variable name, because this variable name is of some data type. So now let's get into the what are the different data types which are available now. The data types which are available here are byte, 1 byte, it is 8 bits, short, 2 bytes, integer, 4 bytes, okay, long, 8 bytes, float, 4 bytes, double, 8 bytes, char, 2 byte character code, example, char c equal to a, boolean, true or false. We can give b is equal to true or false. So let's see an example of data types now. To practice an example of data types, I opened Eclipse as well. Let me open Eclipse. I opened Eclipse. Let me launch it right now. Okay, in Eclipse we'll create a program now. The first program is data types example. To understand this concept, let Eclipse open successfully. Then we'll start creating a project now. So till now we have seen creation of Java program from the command line, but now we'll see how are we going to do it in Eclipse. It takes some time to launch Eclipse. Then we can focus on creation of Java project and also the program. Suppose that after that, once we create the example in for data types, we will try to create understand some of the concepts of conditional statements, logical operator. We'll see some examples on that. Then we can move on to that. Just wait for a few minutes to open. Yeah, I think successfully it is launching now. Okay, it opened now. That list is almost open. So what we have to do here, once it opens successfully, we have to go to workbench. Right hand side, you just click on the workbench. It will go back to the workbench. Now let's create a project. Let me create a Java project here. Create a Java project. Okay, just give the name as say Java Basics. Then you can see here Java Standard Edition 1.8 has been selected here. Right, this section is already selected. Yes, don't change any other options. Just wait. Click on next here. Okay. Now let's understand one more point here. So here, whenever we try to create a project, we can see there is a SRC folder getting created, right? There is a SRC folder getting created. Now we click on finish. Let's see what happens once you click on finish. Click on finish. The SRC folder is nothing but the source folder of the project. Now let's try to open Basics. Let's select SRC. Right click on SRC and we create our first Java program. Say new class, select data types. Okay, now write down the main method. Public static void main. It is important we should write the main method to execute the program. So I have written the main method. Now here let's try to discuss about the data types, right? Byte, b is equal to say 10, say suppose for example short, this is equal to 1 2 3 4. So integer I equal to say max. Similarly, long L equal to, you can just store a very big number than integer. Okay, then you have a float. Float f is equal to say 2.5f double. You don't need to mention any thing else. 2.3.0. That's it. Don't mention any letter here. It means this is double. By default, this will be considered as a double. Then boolean result is equal to either true or false. Then char ch is equal to a single character. So this is how you declare a variable. So how do we read this? B is a variable of type byte, and it has the value which is stored in the variable B is 10. So how do we print B? If you don't print B, what is happening is we are getting some warnings here. Why are these warnings are coming for? These warnings are coming, the reason being, we declare a variable and we store a value, but we didn't use this variable anywhere in the program. So what we should do for that is, we should use this variable now in the program. How do we use the variable in the program? You can say system.out.println syso control select the space bar. There's a shortcut. In Eclipse, we can always depend on the shortcuts. We don't need to write the entire line of statement. That is syso, type syso, hold the control button in the keyboard, click on space bar, and it automatically expand that syso and show the system.out.println. Then we can print the value of byte is, you can mention this B. Similarly, we can put for S, right? Why? Because we declare a variable, we are not using the variable anywhere, we can put S. Like that, we can keep on printing any variable, and we can try to print it in the console. Let me execute the program now. How do I execute the program? First thing, in the command line, we have compiled the program and execute the program. But one good thing about this IDE is we don't need to compile the program. It automatically compiles the program, but we just need to execute the program. So how do we execute the program? Right click on the program, select run as Java application. Again, I repeat, we don't need to compile the program, we just need to execute the program, because compilation happens automatically. Just a Java application, we get the output in the console. See, the value of byte is 10, the value of short is 1, 2, 3, 4. So like that, we can try to store a value in a variable and we can try to print it. So what is the use of the variable? Variables are always useful for us to store a value. And if you are using this variable multiple places, suppose for example, I'm using this variable multiple places, right? Suppose, let me try to use this variable in multiple places. I'm just printing again here, right? So suppose I don't store the value in a variable. Suppose I'm trying to print 10 here. I'm just printing 10 here. Suppose I wanted to update the value of 10 to 20. Is it possible to update in one place? No, we have to update in multiple places. Say 20 here, again 20 here. So what we can do to avoid updating in multiple places, right? We can try to do one thing. We can store 20 in a variable B. And instead of using 20 in the application, in the program mainly, you can just try to select just give B here. So what is the advantage if you try to store a value in a variable? In future, suppose if you wanted to change the value of 20 to 10 back again, I just need to update in a one place in the program. Suppose the program is having so many lines of code, you're using this value in multiple places, then if you wanted to modify, you have to modify in multiple places. So good practice is, it's always important that we have to store a value in a variable and we have to use the variable directly. We should not hard code. What do you mean by hard code? Suppose I just print 20. This is called hard coding. We are not even storing the value in a variable. We're just printing 20. It's not a good practice. We have to store a value in a variable. Then only we can use the variable directly to print the value. Very important, right? And also not only that, we can even store the value in a variable multiple times. Suppose I store 30. Suppose I can come back in the program, end of the program, I can store 40. So what is happening here? So when I try to print B here, so it will like try to look out the latest value the latest value which is stored in B is 40. That is getting printed in the console. Let me print it now. You get the value of B as 40. So this is very important. In real time, we always need to store a value in a variable. That's about data types. The size of the data types, it's always part of the notes. Please refer to the notes. You get some idea. And very important point mainly we use is Boolean, because we always take the conditional statements. If A greater than B, if B greater than A. So those are all conditional statements which returns either true or false. So we have to store that result in a variable like Boolean B is equal to either true or false. Okay, that's important. On char, char is a 2-byte character code. You can store the characters using single quotation, either A or B or C. That's important in the program. Now, very, very important point. String is a class. There is no string S is equal to so-and-so, because a lot of us will get confused. They mention here string S is equal to, say, selenium. I just mentioned here. What does it mean? It doesn't mean that string is a data type. String is a class. So one point we need to remember, string is not a data type. It is an class. Now let's move on further. So this is what I mentioned. So I is declared as int data type assigned to a value of 10, right? So I'd given a lot of information here. Please go through as part of the notes. And also there are some rules for creating variable names. You cannot just like that you can create the variable names. You should follow some rules. Single character is allowed for the variable names. Yes, int I is equal to 10, that's right. Group of characters are allowed for the variable names. Yes, Boolean result is equal to true. Alphanumeric characters are allowed for variable names. Yes, int a1 is equal to 10, b1, c1, d1, student1. Yes, all are possible. Variable names should start with character but not numbers like 1a is equal to 10. This is wrong. Always make sure we start the variable name with the character, not with the number. Keywords are reserved and predefined. It cannot be used for variable names. What does it mean? Suppose let's go back to the program now. You see public, static, void, class, public, all these are keywords in Java. So all keywords are in lowercase. All keywords are in lowercase. These are all predefined. We cannot reuse it. It means when I create a program, when I try to create a variable as int main is equal to 20 or 30, will it be possible? See here, not main. Let's take the class name, the keyboard. It's a keyboard as class. We're storing the int class is equal to 30. Why it is not allowed here? Because class is a keyword which is predefined in Java. You cannot use the class, which is a keyword, as a variable name for storing the value. Okay, so you cannot use this. This we can remove this. This is not possible in the case of Java. Right, then next point, we can don't save it, leave it. Let's go back to the next point. So these are the main important points which are helpful for us to understand what are all the variable names we can create and what are the rules for creating the variable names. Now let's focus on the conditional statements. As part of the agenda today, we're going to cover about conditional statements. When do we need to use these conditional statements? Let's take an example to find the greatest of two numbers, right? Let's take an example of finding greatest of two numbers, right? Let's do that. Okay. So let's say two numbers. Let's put two numbers. Okay. So let's create a main method. Again, hold the control button, click on the space bar. It automatically shows the dot form to be converted into the actual line of statement, public static void main. Just create two variables, int a is equal to 20, int b is equal to 30. You can do like this, or else you can say int a is equal to 20, comma b is equal to 30. Anything is fine. You can define all the declarations and assignment of the variables in one line of statement. You can remove this also. So int a is equal to 20 and b is equal to 30. Now, if a greater than b, it's a conditional statement. If this is true, go inside. Print a is greater than. If this doesn't happen, else, just mention here b is greater than. So what's happening here is it is important that these conditional statements using if else will help us to identify the number which is greater than in these two numbers like a and b. Let me execute the program now to see the outcome. Select the program now, right click, run as Java application. So b is greater than a. Why? Because b is 30, a is 20. Let's change the values to see our logic is working as expected or not. It is always important we have to check the logic is working or not, because just now it executed b is greater than a. Now we have to see the value a is greater than b and also see that we're getting the same output in the console or not accordingly. Just click on it. Click on the execute button. A is greater than b. So it's always important we will try to validate the logic with the different values. Just don't focus on else part. Also make sure we need to make sure that it will always goes to if else, if conditional statement also to get the output. Now let's look into another program of new class, say let us have three numbers, right? Let's take three numbers. This will be a little interesting point now. Let's look into this. But if you wanted to see the greatest of three numbers, before that, let's understand the truth table concept in Java. Truth table. Mainly, in the case of truth table, so we have two operators like logical and, logical or. So in the logical and, if there is a conditional statement which returns true, and if there is a conditional statement which returns true, true is true here, and true false is false, false true is false again, false is false. So in the case of logical operator and, it will be true only in one scenario where the two conditional statements, like if a greater than b and a greater than c, then these two conditional statements are true, then you get the result as true. But unlike logical operator and, if you look into logical operator or, true always true, true false it is true again, false true again, it is false only in one scenario, false here, right? So these two tables are important. Let's get into the logic now, identification of greatest of three numbers. Let's take int a is equal to 20, from b is equal to 100, c is equal to say 230. Any three numbers we take. So how do we write a logic here? We write a logic as if a greater than b and a greater than c, what do we mention here? System.out.println a is greatest. Is, and you can even print value of a. Yeah, then else if b greater than a, and also else if b greater than a and b greater than c, we can mention here b is greatest. Else mention c is great. Only one thing is pending, which is c is greatest. We can mention here c. Then if I execute the program, what is the outcome now? Let me execute the program. Right click on the program, run as Java application. So we get the output as C is greatest. Why? Because out of all the three numbers, C is greatest. Suppose if you want, you can change it as well. Just make it as 320 and save it. And again execute. If you wanted to execute again and see, yes, go ahead and execute it. You can just see this is the one, this is the button. We can just click on it. Section. And we get A is greatest, which is 320. Right? So like this, we can even check a conditional statement by passing different values to get the output. So if you look into the agenda now, we discussed Java introduction, Java execution flow, variables, data types, conditional statements with examples. We have seen two examples. Example one, greatest of two numbers. Example two, greatest of three numbers. So all these two examples we covered in the day one. So please go through the video and let me know if you have any questions. Try to provide if you have any questions, just update in the video section of the YouTube channel, then I'll reply back to us. Okay, so that's it for the day one. Let's meet and discuss about in the day two agenda and also cover some topics. Okay.